Today we are going to talk about adaptations to a niche, page 275. Okay, now first of all, what do you mean by adaptation and what do you mean by niche? Niche means the role of an organism in a community. There may be many different types of organisms in a population which make up a community. So we need to know the role of each organism in the community. Or in other words, in simple language, you can say the job description of their living in that particular habitat. But what is an adaptation? An adaptation means how well a species is fit to an environment because of its structure, because of its function, because of its behavior. Either it could be because of a mutation. What will aid in the survival of that organism? What aids the survival of an organism depends upon many successful adaptations. Or in short, how a species is successfully able to live in an area. That is what is we call as an adaptation to a niche. There are many different types of adaptations. We will be familiarizing today with three different types of adaptation for a successful living in an area. One, it could be an anatomical adaptation. What do you mean by an anatomical adaptation? This is the form or the structure of an organism which is within the animal. So it can be given to its gametes. All the animals that this animal's offspring will be having, animal or plant, all the offsprings will be having these adaptation generation after generation. So this we call it as an anatomical adaptation. Whereas if there is any change in the programmed behavior or an instinctive behavior of an animal or an act of an animal for its survival, we call it as a behavioral adaptation. And another one is physiological adaptation, which means the way in which the biochemical pathway or the enzymatic reactions in an organism, it could be a plant or an animal, to adapt to carry out its living in that particular environment is said to be called a physiological adaptation. I will give you a lot of examples to make you understand. For example, a social behavior. Let's say chimpanzees, wild dogs, dolphins, all of them hunting as a team. That type is a behavioral adaptation. Another example, otters, penguins, turtles, leopards, all of them huddling together so that warmth can be spread within them, so that they can be having a higher chances of survival. The full group will get that advantage. So that's a behavioral adaptation. Butterflies, cranes, goose, whales, all these animals, to avoid harsh environmental conditions, they might be migrating to a different area. So that's again another behavioral adaptation. How about owls, deers, wolves, and even you learned about peacock. These animals will show a particular behavioral courtship ritual, which is also an adaptation, which is a behavioral adaptation. So right now you understood a lot of the adaptations which is involving a change in the behavior pattern or an act of an organism so that it can be better adapted for its survival. This we call it as a behavioral adaptation. I'll give you some examples of anatomical adaptation. That means it is within the organism, it's in the structure of the organism. For example, scaly tail for the porcupine and webbed feet for the beavers, that's an adaptation for them in its anatomy. Whiskers and claws for otters, that's an adaptation in its anatomy. Another example is all the insectivorous plants to capture the insects, because they live in a region where there is less amount of nutrients in the soil, or you could say nitrate content will be less in the soil where they live. So they will have an adaptation in which they will have some very special sticky sensory hairs. So if an insect is moving around, that insect can be quickly trapped, and after capturing the insect, the chemicals and the enzymes will help in digesting them. That's a physiological adaptation. So this have an anatomical and physiological adaptations to help in its survival. Now the physiological adaptation is, as I told you, the biochemical pathway or enzymatic reaction which will help the organism to survive. In this case, we can talk about some examples which can make you understand easily is training for, let's say, athletes. We will be undergoing mountain training, a region which is little raised from the sea level, so that these people will become more adapted for their conditions in the real fight. That means in the real race. Let it be a sprinter. The sprinter is training in a mountain region, so his oxygen carrying capacity in the blood will increase, which means that these athletes will start developing more red blood cell, more oxyhemoglobin, which means the muscle can work more effectively and they can be the winners in the race. Similarly, diving athletes or diving mammals, they also have a very special adaptation which comes under physiological adaptation. This we call slowing down the heart rate, which is said to be called as bradycardia. Figure B, have a look at the picture. You could see that heart rate drops significantly when the mammal is underwater. That means only the necessary amount of oxygen will be in the blood so that the animal can undergo sufficient living underwater for such a long time. Very minimum amount of oxygen will be carried in the blood. But after a certain time, in this picture, somewhere it started from 0.2 and it ends in 4.5, somewhere like that. That means that 4.1 or 4.2 minutes, the animal can be underwater with this diving response. Only minimal necessary oxygen will be carried in the blood. This bradycardia is also a physiological adaptation for this animal. Now, animals, for their survival, they will have lot of different types of adaptations shown by the animal in that particular environment. One classic example is a fungi, which could be a saprophyte, but this fungi can undergo a predatory behavior when it is living in an environment where there is very low nitrogen content. This fungi definitely need nitrate, but the soil is with very less nitrate. So the animal will show three types of behavior. One is behavioral adaptation, and one is anatomical adaptation, and one is physiological adaptation. How is that possible? This fungi can obtain its nitrogen content from some nematodes living in that soil. How is that possible? The fungi will produce sticky nets or adhesive pads to trap the worm. And once it is trapping the worm, it is producing a special type of hyphae which can produce concentric rings. These rings are anatomical adaptation, but this is made with the help of a physiological adaptation by changing the osmotic potential so that more water movement will be there. So the ring can expand and the ring can trap the worm so that the worm will not be able to move when it is trying to escape. Within few hours, the fungi will penetrate into the body of the nematode, and with the physiological adaptation, it will be spreading out a lot of enzymes. And this is an act in which the fungi will be able to digest the nematode and absorb all the nutrients. Thus, the fungi can live in an area where there is less nitrate. So this shows three types of adaptations for this fungi, which was a saprophytic fungi, but behaved as carnivorous or a predatory behavior. Now, they can ask me a lot of questions related to this. For example, we will discuss some more of the animals, and then I will give you one question for you to do. The example is, we will talk about camel. Have a look at the picture. Figure E, you could see a camel with lot of anatomical adaptations. Will you be able to identify if they give a picture like this? For example, Look at the eyes, large eyes you can see. That means definitely it's an anatomical adaptation, because all the camels will have that. Its offsprings will all have, which is for protecting the eye. The vision will be big so that the eyes are big, but there will be long lashes, which is to protect the eye, because they live in an area where there is a lot of sand. If there is heavy wind blowing, the sand will enter inside the eye, so they can quickly blink, and this lash will protect them. Then they have large slit on the nose, which you can see the nostrils. They also will protect them against the sand when it is highly windy condition. Then look at the upper lip, the hairy extensible region. That is also help them to sniff and help to understand which is the food and which is to avoid, whether the plant is having high amount of thorns. They can understand that. Hump on the back. This can come in many different ways of adaptation. Now we are talking about anatomical adaptation. That means this will be insulating the animal from the heat of the sun. But we will talk about the fat metabolism as another adaptation. Look at the feet. The feet is large and it is flat with tough pads. So that also will help them to carry its weight. And look at the knee portion. You can see tough pad, which will prevent them from excessive heat in the environment when the camel is resting. So like that, when you look at an animal, and you should be able to identify this animal's adaptation. Now we can talk about some physiological adaptation of this camel. Camels definitely live in desert environment, so it should have a lot of different type of biochemical pathway or enzymes that will help them to survive in that condition. They have the skin which is covered with fine hairs, and you know that this hair can trap a layer of cold air and insulate this animal during night. The camel can withstand a very high variation in body temperature. For example, if you take human, supposing we can withstand about 2 degrees, not more than that, but camel can have a thermoregulation of about 6 degree change. This is very good for them to save energy and to save water, so they don't sweat extensively. 30% of their body weight loss can be managed by drinking 10 minutes water. See how amazing physiological change is adapted. Then, as I told you, fat can be of two different ways. The hump, one can be an anatomical, that means to insulate them. Now we will talk about physiological, which means the fat can be broken down. Metabolism of the fat will give in a lot of water. So the animal without drinking water can also survive. With this water, it can avoid drinking water, or if there is no water also, it can survive in this hostile environment. Then we can talk about one more, which is very important, that is dromedary camels. The red blood cells can withstand expanding 240% of its original volume. In many animals, only 150%, and then the cell will burst. But if this is not bursting, means animal can drink a lot of water. The blood can be diluted, but still the blood cells will not be damaged. That's a very good adaptation. Then we'll talk about some behavioral adaptation of camels. One of the behavioral adaptation is when the body is extremely hot and the animal need to sweat, right? So that the animal can withstand the conditions of the heat. But still, even after sweating a lot, water loss is a lot, still the animal can produce dilute milk even when it is hydrated. So that is an adaptation which is in its behavior. Even it can control the water content in the urine. Minimum water can be lost in the urine. So that's a behavioral adaptation. Plus it's an anatomical adaptation because it has a long loop of Henle. So that long loop of Henle is in all camels. It's in its anatomy. So that's an anatomical adaptation. Then camels eat a lot variety of food. Why a lot variety of food? So that this can make them in many different conditions to survive. Even if the food is insect, it can survive. If it is, let's say, reptiles, still it can eat it and survive. So that is a behavioral adaptation. Wide range of vegetation, the height, shrubs and trees and all of them, many animals cannot reach them. But because of the height of the camel, it can reach them. So that is also in any challenging niche, it can survive. Then another behavioral adaptation, like what we told before, many camels can lie together. Obviously, we live in a desert, so you know that you might have seen that many camels lying together. This is minimizing the amount of the surface area exposure to the sun, so more heat can be kept within. Curdling together, that behavioral exposure. Other than this also, camel can have a lot of survival adaptation in general. For example, even if they are not drinking water for 10 days, they can survive. So it's a behavioral adaptation. Camel can drink about 180 liters of water within 24 hours, another adaptation, without even changing its osmotic potential. As I told you, 240% expansion can be possible of the red blood cell without being bursting. That's a wonderful adaptation. Like that, camel can have a lot of adaptation. So each adaptation, when you learn, identify whether it is anatomical or physiological or behavioral, and you will be explaining why is it this type of adaptation. Now I will send you a question. Try to answer this, and then we will check out with the answer whether you all are with me or not. Cacti have modified leaves and spines. The reduction in the size decreases the number of pores, stomata, through which water can be lost to the air. Definitely you all thought it is anatomical, right? Yes, correct. You all wrote it correct, anatomical. Rat-tailed maggot, which lives in water with low oxygen concentration, has a long breathing tube that ends from its extend from its body to just above the water surface. This allows the animal to take oxygen from the air above the water. Atmospheric air contains more oxygen than water. Yes, you all got it correct, anatomical. Kidneys of some desert mammals are modified long loop of enlay to reduce the water loss by producing very concentrated urine. Also, many of you got it correct as anatomical, which means this full table, all of them were anatomical. Now look the second column. Some ectothermic, that means the cold-blooded organisms such as lizard, orient themselves to maximize their absorption of the heat from sun until they reach their active temperature. Also, many of you got it correct, behavioral, you all wrote it. A single-celled organism reverses its direction if it accidentally moves into an unfavorable condition from more favorable condition. Also, most of you got it correct as behavioral. And the last column, people who move from sea level to high up a mountain region, increasing the oxygen carrying capacity to produce more red blood cell, physiological. Also, many people got it correct. Formation of hard skin on the hand due to the repeated pressure, that is physiological. Also, many people got it correct. Those who didn't get this correct, now I will send the answer also. So it will be clear. The question and the answer both are forwarded. So please check, then you will understand what I told. Okay. Now I will also ask two more questions just to make sure that you, few of you did not answer. So I will ask a question. You can type the answer. Bee orchid flower looks similar to insects. Bee orchid flowers look similar to insects. What type of adaptation is it? Anatomical, behavioral, physiological. You can just type A or B or P. Bas, that will do. Then I'll understand that you got the answer correct. Bee orchid flowers look similar to insects. Yes. Three of you typed it as anatomical. That means I think many people understood it as anatomical. Yeah. Now, another question. A peahen is said to select her peacock mate on the size and shape of his tail. Size and shape of its tail. Yeah, many people are responding B, B, B. Yes, correct. That means it is a behavioral adaptation. Now, let me ask you a change in the environment, whether you can understand that correctly. Okay. There is a table which I'm going to read for you. You will just tell me what is the environmental change. Then I'll understand that you got this idea correct. For example, the question is, a small UK mammal has extended its range north over the last 50 years. What environmental change made the animal extended its range north over the last 50 years? Is it because of the diet, or is it because of Diet meaning no food or less food or more food, or is it because of the global warming, the temperature change, or is it because of competition among animals? What do you think? Yeah, yes, you got it correct. Global warming. Most of the people told global warming. A small UK mammal extended its range north over the last 50 years. One got it wrong. One told it is less food. No. How about this? Tooth shape has become different in foxes that live in a city compared with foxes that live in a countryside. Tooth shape. That means they are talking about, is it global warming or competition or diet change? Yes, you got it correct. Many of the people wrote it as diet. So if they ask the environmental change, you should be able to know the environmental change. If they ask you whether it is anatomical, physiological or behavioral change, you should be able to tell about that also. So I suppose this adaptation part is a little bit clear for you. Now we will go to gene pool and genetic diversity. First of all, we will explain what is a population. A population is a group of individuals at a particular time in a particular niche or in a particular habitat. So population is a group of individuals. That means we are speaking about only one type of individuals, one species in a particular niche at a particular time, that we call it as population. The sum total of all the alleles in a population, we call it as gene pool. This is a very important idea that a population of organisms will have a particular gene pool, which means they will have different alleles and the frequency of the alleles will also be different. Now, how do we understand the allele frequency of a population? Is it fixed or is it changing? Obviously, you understand. Just now we learned that adaptation. An adaptation is needed only if there is a change in the environment. If there is a change in the environment, this can be a powerful selection pressure tool. We know that. And a selective advantage should be there for this animal. Therefore, the change in the environment, some alleles will have more advantageous feature for this particular change. And if an animal can adapt to that particular change, that animal or that individual will contain some allele in that population, which we call as an allele frequency, which can adapt with the change. Most of the time, it's very difficult to understand this adaptation or this selection pressure if you just check the external frequency. So again, we need to know how many dominant alleles, how many recessive alleles, and how many homozygous condition, heterozygous condition are in one population. I'll give you one more example to make it more clearer. The presence or absence of one allele in an environment will only be determined by a selection pressure, which means, is this allele giving a better advantage or no advantage can only be identified if this population is exposed to one particular selection pressure. For example, if we are introducing a chemical that can help to poison the rat will definitely die with warfarin. It's a very strong, powerful poison. But year after year, when this poison was introduced, some of the rats did not die. That means they underwent a selective advantage and they had some resistant allele to withstand that selection, and rapidly their population started increasing. The ones which are fit were able to survive, and the survived ones had that particular resistant allele and it passed on to its offspring. When it passed on to its offspring, all the offsprings further developed had that particular allele and they were able to survive. Now, the same idea. Now, we were talking about warfarin. So, for example, the presence or absence of this allele, resistant allele, we will understand only if rats are exposed to this warfarin. If there is no exposure to warfarin, we will not even know whether there is an allele which can be a resistant allele or not. But to understand this, the frequency of this allele, whether it is a dominant allele or whether it is a resistant allele, it's not at all easy to understand externally. So we have to have a calculation in which we can understand the frequency of dominant allele, the frequency of recessive allele. So this calculation is very simple. And this simple equation was formed by two scientists, a mathematician and a physician, Hardy and Weinberg. So we coined it as Hardy-Weinberg law. They did it independently, but now this equation is used as a mathematical relationship where the frequency of alleles and the genotype within a stable population, the population should not be evolving, then only we can calculate. And this is called Hardy-Weinberg equation, which is very easy. That means what we are doing is there is no evolutionary influence. One generation to another generation, the population will remain stable if the allele frequency in the population is stable. That means when a new species is formed, gene flow will be reduced because there is no more breeding between the two original populations. So we want to calculate it. Is it possible whether a population from generation after generation, it can stay the same or not? Which means there should be no mutation, there should be random mating, the population should be very large, the population should not be migrating, and there is no environmental change, there is no selection pressure. In real world, this condition is never possible. But we can calculate the gene pool equilibrium by using this formula. That's all. So it's an algebraic equation where we say P plus Q is equal to 1. I repeat one more time. We say P plus Q is equal to 1, where we are talking about homozygous recessive allele, which is represented as Q, and dominant allele is represented as P. So what are we doing? P plus Q is equal to 1. This is a very simple relationship, but it is a very useful relationship. In this, P is the dominant allele representation and Q is the recessive allele representation. So P plus Q is equal to 1, or we can even tell it as P square plus 2PQ plus Q square is equal to 1. So both this equation we are going to employ in one of the example and see how we will check the populations, whether the population is having an equilibrium or not in an equilibrium. The gene pool equilibrium is what we are going to check. For example, there's a worked out example. We'll go over it, page 278. Look at the figure B. There is an alligator shown there, which is an albino. It's very easy to understand albino alligators because they are easily observable that they have only recessive alleles. If there is only recessive alleles, it will become albino because there is nothing to mask, you know that. But if it is a homozygous dominant or a heterozygous condition, we will not be able to understand whether it is hetero or homozygous dominant. So that's why we have to use Hardy-Weinberg equation to estimate the genotype frequencies. This is mostly the use of Hardy-Weinberg law, which means Hardy-Weinberg equation is always used to estimate the genotype frequencies. Now have a look at the worked example in page 278. We are going to calculate. They are telling you have studied the inheritance of albino trait. People who inherit the trait for dominant pigmented trait may have the genotype capital A, capital A, or capital A, small a. People who are albinos are homozygous for the allele determining the recessive phenotype small a, small a. As I told you, from externally, it is very easy to understand whether it is a recessive individual because it is albino. It can have no masking allele in it, so it will be small a, small a. Test on the sample of North American shown that the frequency of albinos in a population was 1 out of 20,000. This tells the frequency of Q square of the homozygous recessive trait is 1 over 20,000. So they calculated the value of Q square. So we got the Q square there. After getting the Q square, you can understand what is Q, which is the square root of this figure, and thus they got the Q value also. Now we know the formula P plus Q is equal to 1. So when we know the formula P plus Q is equal to 1, we even know that P can be calculated because we know Q, right? So you know Q and you know P. Now P plus Q is equal to 1. So we know P, we know Q. So you can write P square and Q square and calculate the value of heterozygous, which is 2PQ. 2PQ is equal to that of capital A small a. So just go over this, and thus the frequency you got for A and small a, capital A small a and small a capital A together also. That means we got the frequency of homozygous dominant, heterozygous and homozygous recessive. Now we have to check this, whether you understood this or not. To check that, there is one question in page 280. I want you to try out the first question in 280 page. In a population of plants, 95 out of 200 individuals express homozygous recessive phenotype for hairy leaves. Calculate the percentage of the population that is homozygous for the recessive phenotype and the percentage of the population that is heterozygous and the frequency of the homozygous for the dominant phenotype in the population. When you do this, only I will understand that you are with me. So we will check the first one. The first, the percentage of population that is homozygous for the recessive phenotype. We will do that, okay? We will do it